Thank you very much, Andrea. It's great to be back, and we should have more interactions because, you know, geographically we're not that far away, right? So the talk today, there's a long title, Internet of Things and Cloud Computing, and I'll try to do a mixture of, you know, a couple of equations, some of the advances we have done in the issue of modeling and understanding the trade-offs when you have to deploy a service that senses things and sends them to a cloud. And then show you a couple of practical testbeds. One of them is this little camera that is here. It's not recording you. It's picking up images, but they're not stored, so you shouldn't worry. If people are worried, I'll point it this way. Yeah. And of course, this is collaborative work with a number of people that I'm listing below. Some of them were PhD students, some of them are, were postdocs, and I have a dual affiliation. The second affiliation is with a startup called Diven that I'm one of the co-founders, and that handles the cloud computing aspects that I'll show you later. If people have brought, you know, a smartphone or a laptop, you can also try some of the things I'll show you in real time along with me. And by all means, interrupt me with questions. I'm happy to make it as interactive as people would like it to be. So this is the very brief overview. There are the overall scope is trade-offs in IoT applications, devices, and public cloud infrastructures. There's a bit of theory in the beginning with a simple model with partial moment theory that explains a bit how one can understand trade-offs from the sensing and the processing side. And then I'll summarize what we are doing currently with these DVS cameras and also some practical testbeds that we run in the cloud. And hopefully you may do some of this yourselves if you have interest. So a general model for an IoT and cloud service today and for some time is what you see here. So you have a number of devices with cameras or with other sensory equipment. And most of them are wireless. And they basically collect data. They may do some local processing. They usually do some local processing, and then they send the data to some notion of an aggregator, which is a device that collects data from a cluster of these devices, and then that sends it up to the cloud service, which performs some sort of search retrieval, you know, matching of things, analytics. And in terms of protocols, what is being used today, it's for the MAC and physical layer, you use something like, and for the network layer from the sensor side, 6LoWPAN, and possibly, you know, 802.15.4 as a low power analogy to the Wi-Fi protocol, especially at the MAC layer, and MQTT for the messaging. MQTT, for those of you that are not familiar, it's a application layer messaging protocol. It's like HTTP for sensors, basically. You can create short messages which are wrapped in the MQTT format, and they are sent from the devices to the aggregator, and the aggregator can aggregate them and send them to the cloud. It's important because when you are studying, for example, latency and processing, some of it could be coming from this, from the application layer MQTT packaging, basically. Okay. Now, what is the uplink and what is the downlink typically? The uplink is typically feature vectors or queries. And I'll show you an example of what these feature vectors are, and I'm very sure people in this room have played around with extracting features from visual data and similar applications. And what you want to control in the uplink is how much data do you collect and send to the aggregator, and how much data do you send from the aggregator to the cloud service, right? So the min rate and traffic statistics,
And what you want to have in the downlink is you want to have retrieved results that are coming from the cloud service. And also, in terms of control, you want to control your cloud billing cost and other parameters like reaction time or scale up of the service in the cloud. If, for example, you have a surge, some big event is happening and suddenly a lot of these little sensors wake up and start sending a lot of data, how do you manage the surge of processing demand in the cloud, and how much does that cost you when you do that? Here's an example of a sort of a current visual feature extraction case. Is anybody participating in this Kaggle competition? Have you seen it recently? So it's an interesting one. So this is. They started, Google wrote this paper with this YouTube ATEM dataset, right? And YouTube ATEM is 8 million videos from YouTube that have been collected through some filtering and sorting process that Google and YouTube spent the time for. For example, they have an automatic tagging mechanism at the back end of the YouTube service that produces tags of activity or content for particular video. These tags are noisy, of course, and they could be very diverse or very unbalanced. So then there is a tag filtering and some manual sorting of these tags. So they started with the order of 20 million videos or more, and after several layers of pruning, they ended up with 8 million videos and about, I think, 4,000 or 5,000 labels. And what they have released is features per video frame and labels per video. Not per video frame, per video. So it could say, dancing or, combat, martial arts, whatever, karate, XYZ, right? And the idea is that they have this open competition, which is active now, and it's going for the next 2 months, that says take the features. They also give something like $300 of cloud computing time on the Google Cloud per team. And they say, try and find a classification mechanism that achieves the best accuracy in this data set, right? Now, what are the good and the bad things about it? The bad thing is these 8 million videos, if you download them as MP4 files, they are about 800 something terabytes, compressed. So obviously that's usually not a good idea. If you get the features that they give, it's about 1.7 terabytes. And what are the features? The features they give per frame is they take a very deep CNN, which is an architecture called Inception, and that has multiple filtering layers and also some jumps across the layers and so on. And basically, per frame, they pass through all the layers of the network and they aggregate the last layers. Then they do a PCA projection and some normalization and quantization, and they come up with a single vector of 1,024 integers per frame, and that's what you get. And the frames are sampled at one frame per second. Okay. And that's about 1.7 terabytes. Now, there's been a bit of, if you look at the discussion forums and all these kind of things around this, there's a bit of drama around this. Some people are saying, give us access to the PCA matrix you're using so we can understand exactly how the features have been produced by the neural network. Because the problem is once you do this PCA here and you get this vector, it's not a reversible process if you don't know how the PCA works, right? And of course, they say, the competition is about matching these features to the labels, and they don't expect people to try and get frames to do it. They say that they've done it, and they expect the competitors to just do the machine learning.
basically on top of it. But I'm just putting it here as an example of, you know, these videos could be coming from sensors, for example, or from any other service, and you have a number of features, and then you have to do some sort of matching, similarity, classification problems, and so on, using a cloud service. So that's a kind of analogy to our Internet of Things and cloud computing. Now, another example is all the family of startups and services that say use your mobile phone as an authentication device, basically, right? So log in your bank account, enter the building, pay for something without typing, but just the camera taking your photo, basically. So that means that there is a sort of a, you see your face and you say tap to log in. Then video frames are captured, features are extracted again with some notion of a CNN or a kernel method. These features are sent to a central database. There is a distance calculation and a number of iterations to ensure statistical significance. And then basically, you know, depending on the identification rate, you get authenticated or not. And of course, the cloud, when you have multiple of these devices, you know, doing this surge of logins, you may need to scale the resources in the cloud, add more servers to do the distance calculations, or adjust the number of attempts you will allow per user. And there's always a timing constraint, because obviously if this is not responsive within, you know, a few seconds, the user thinks that the app crashed or you know, or somehow it's not really working well, right? So that's another typical example of IoT and backend processing in the cloud. any question or comment until now? No? Okay. Now, now, looking at the device and what are the trade-offs in energy at the device, right? You have time here, and what you see in this graph is basically the power consumption of a very simple sensor, which is not even having a camera, and does basic sensing of time series like temperature or vibration. And you have a sort of, and how do we measure this? You can take, for example, a simple resistor, put it in series or in parallel to your device. Let's say this is the device. Measure the current consumption in the resistor with a very high frequency oscilloscope. And then, you know, with basic first year circuit math, you can infer, you can estimate the current consumption on the device. You know the resistance of the device from the manufacturer, so then you can get power in real time at very high frequency. And you can plot that across time. And you see that, for example, the device has certain modes. For example, the processing and transmitting mode is this high burst, high peak mode. Then you have an idling mode where it could be buffering, or it could be just waiting for the transmit period to finish, sending, for example, short packets. And then there is a sleep mode, where you have this sort of grain noise, where, you know, some system interrupts happening and very little power consumption. And actually, this power profile, for simple devices like this, you may think you can analyze it, but when you go to complex devices like this one, or, you know, even more complex like a mobile phone, it becomes very complex to see the micro behavior and the micro states of different power modes, right? So, and that's a problem, because obviously, you know, when you deploy a service like this, recording and authenticating, or any other service of feature extraction, etc., the one thing you don't want is eating the battery too quickly, or not being able to predict the resources well, because then people would just not use it. For example, if the authentication works, but when I do it four times, then I need to charge my phone, then, you know, it's not going to work, right? Or if you have bursts in power, that's also a problem, because not only it will damage the battery of the device, it will also, what's the other problem? Anybody knows? When you have power surges from an application on a mobile phone, it's too hot. Becomes too hot, basically. Yeah. So what I'm trying to say here is that you also want to control the power profile, as in the average energy consumption over the activity modes of the application, when it's authenticating someone or when it's idling or when it's sending data. But not just the average, but also the bursts of power. And you want to have control on both to have a viable service for a device that is, you know, connecting to a cloud, right? Now, going to the cloud side, the other problem today is that so beyond the power and the energy on the device, understanding the cloud side and the trade-offs there is also complex. In what sense? That you have, for example, different pricing schemes per gigabyte of storage when you download it or when you store it there. Per instance type you are using, and also based on the configuration of the instance. If you use auto-scaling to start more servers or shut them down based on thresholds. Depending on what type of computing and whether you are actually using the virtual machine or not, and what type of virtual machine you are using, you also have different options here. So for example, in Amazon Web Services, there is a different pricing when you use on-demand instances, spot instances, reserved instances, and all that. The good news is that the control tools, something like Docker to run packages on the virtual machines, or Hadoop for scheduling and execution of parallel jobs, these are usually given free. So that's fine. So overall, from the pricing side, when you deploy a service that needs to use cloud servers at scale, that's also difficult to use and requires a lot of attention to all these complex parameters. And it's difficult for someone to understand a priori how can I design it and what is it going to cost me for different operational modes and different surge levels, right? And the other element is reliability versus cost, which I'm not going to discuss here. And that reliability means when servers suddenly disappear in the cloud, yeah? Which may happen more often than we think. And here's an example of a control panel in Amazon, for example. And you see you have to manage key pairs, placement groups, which region in the world you're running your servers, how do you manage security, how do you allocate IPs, instance numbers, and all these other things. So that the standard response of people in academia when they try to approach this is what? Is to not do it. Basically, walk away and use your friend's computers or use whatever server you can get your hand. Am I right or not? I think I am, because at least for UCL, that's the standard response. People have tried, they get messed up with all the keys and pricing, and suddenly they see a huge bill, and they say, you know what? Whatever. I'm just going to run on my own computers. It will take longer. It's not going to scale as well, but you know. So that's sort of the motivation I'm trying to give. It's complex to analyze and manage the costs in these services, right? And here's a slide with all the parameters put together. For example, starting from the system parameters, you have energy rates to transmit, process, and when the device is idling. You also have from the billing side, the billing rates I mentioned, the number of devices, the rules when you increase or decrease the number of servers. And from the data gathering side, you also have the gathering rate, so the number of features you are producing per second, and the statistics. What is the probability density function that models the features you're producing, the number of them, you know, across an interval of time, right? What is the maximum volume of features you can handle? What is the mean per activity and per type of sensor and all that? And what you want to optimize from the analysis side is, for example, how many nodes to deploy in a particular service while I'm minimizing the billing cost? What is the mean rate of queries or features I can send to the cloud that optimizes the billing? The notion of coupling is something I will mention in the following slides, and the coupling in this type of modeling that I'll present briefly here is a key aspect. And also, can there be a reliable estimation of the cloud billing for a particular service that is minimum, that gives you the least possible cost, right? And here's a simple example for this process. Let's say we've deployed the process and we've measured a very simple profile like this. So we have active period where we transmit on average GE joule, we consume on average GE joule per bit every time we send a bit in this period. There's an idling period where we consume on average IE joule per bit, which is less, of course. And then there's a sleep period that we ignore, right? Because that's minimum. Now, depending on the data, we could be completely active, completely processing and transmitting for the entire duration, or we could be completely idle, right? And we just don't know that, because it depends on the number of activities that the device will capture. So a simple way to understand how to handle this from the capturing side is to assume that the query production rate or the feature production rate is a random variable, which says a density function and some notion of expectation usually, right? And then you can introduce the notion of coupling by saying that if my query production rate is below a certain ratio of the mean value, so CE is a number, for example, it could be 1. If CE is 1, if your rate is below the mean, then you can assume that you are mostly in the idle state. If your rate is above the mean, you are mostly in the active state, right? So that introduces a two-state modeling of the problem. You can introduce more than two states, but you can, conceptually it's easy to start from a two-state process, right? What the CE is, this is what we are trying to find out, basically. So what is the best value to use so that we can design the service appropriately? And that CE, the ratio, depends. Either you can either control it or it comes from the device itself. For example, if you have a fixed power profile like this, that CE could be something that is device dependent. You can't change it that much. But what you can do is when you're designing a service is you can find the value of CE for different devices so you know what to buy or what device not to buy for the service, right? So again, if we assume we are in the idle mode, we consume IE joule per bit. If we're in the active mode, we consume GE joule per bit. And then you can simply write the expected energy consumption over a period of t seconds from this equation. And that equation says what you will consume is the amount of bits, the expected amount of bits over that period, times the active, so this is what was transmitted, plus the idle power consumption rate, which is based on this, and this is simply the partial moment. So it says from 0 bits to the coupling, the difference between the coupling and what you transmit times the density function. And that will give you the expected energy. This is the amount of time, if you like, the amount of energy coming from idle. And this is the amount of energy coming from active periods. Yes? No? Yeah? And then you have, of course, the upper-sided energy. If you want to also, this controls the expected value of the power, of the energy, right? The upper-sided energy variability, which is important in the device overheating or in the power surge mode, is you can calculate the second moment and say, for example, the partial second moment is the square of the active period from the moment I enter the active period to infinity, of the difference, of what I'm sending minus the coupling, right, squared, times the density function. And that will give you the variability, the upper-sided energy variability, which is parametrical, of course, to the consumption rate of the active mode and the coupling and the statistics, the expected value and the density, right? And typically you want to have some control in the notion of having some understanding of what is the mean value you want to have for the energy consumption over an interval of time. For example, the energy consumption per day when I'm using the app. And what is the power surge, the energy surge I can have, which is also bounded by some value app dev here, right? And the same for the cloud side. The nice thing about this type of model is because you're modeling over a period of time, like a day, you can also assume that the billing model can follow a similar notion. And that means that you have a query production rate. And that query production rate, to explain what it is, it's this. I have to go back. It's what I'm sending from an aggregator, which has collected everything here, to the cloud service. So the aggregated query rate, right? And you can also model it with partial moments and say that, first we have to understand what is the trade-off here. If we have an idle period when I'm not getting a lot of queries in the cloud, then I run a small number of servers, like 3 servers, for example. When I have a surge, I will start like 10 times more servers, and I go to 30. Of course, these numbers are just parameters, the 3 and the 30, right? And the way to control the surge and the switch in auto-scaling is to have another coupling parameter for the volume of queries. So if I'm below this number, I'm in idle. If I'm above, I'm in active mode, right? And that could be tuned based on the number of devices and so on. And in terms of cost, you can know the cost, again, with some estimation, because you can say for a particular instance type, to process a single query of that size, I need 10 milliseconds. And the cost per hour of that instance is 1 cent. So that means that, you know, I can infer the cost per query on average, right? And again, I have 2 costs, one for the idle state when I'm using 3 servers and one for the active state when I'm using 30 servers here, right? And you can write a similar equation to what I had before, which is your average query volume times the active spend plus the idle with a partial moment when I'm in idle mode from 0 to the coupling here, plus the active from the coupling to infinity when I am in active mode. And that will give you an estimation of the billing, which is of course parametrical to the coupling that you are assuming, and these costs. And the cost for idle and active depend on the particular instances you are using and the numbers of these instances. So then the thing with this partial moment modeling is very simple, but it links all the parameters together. And then you also have a cost, as in I want to pay per month this much to the cloud provider, right? So I want to control this expected billing to be this. And the other nice thing is, because you have the statistics of your query production rates here as the density functions, you can produce a number of results which are in closed form. Because you can replace different density functions for any PDF. First, you can show that you can find single solutions when you have constraints, for example, on the energy variability and conditional to the expected energy not exceeding something. And you can find in a similar way the coupling that minimizes the billing cost for any PDF. And more than that, you can also express the number of devices per cluster that will achieve these constraints. So even though the model is simple, you can do an exploration conditional to the parameters of your devices and find a closed form answer to particular questions. Like, for example, when I have a particular energy variability minimization problem subject to the expected value of the energy cost, right? And we, you know, the related paper, which I will point to in a bit, gives several examples when we run, for example, with the BeagleBone platform and the backend using the Didn service and Amazon Web Services, right? And this is the paper which was the first author is Francesco Rena, and it is I think it has appeared in Transactions on Multimedia. So it says to appear, but I think it has already appeared. What I want to say here, and I'll show you some results, but the results are, you know, it's sort of what you expect in a way. The nice thing about these partial moment models is that they are used a lot in finance and physics. Why is that? Because in both cases, you have a lot of independent observations or experiments. In physics, they are sort of particles, and this expresses properties of the particles to be, you know, in a particular state or in another state. In finance, it expresses particular observations of, for example, stock prices or things like that. And the nice thing about partial moments is you can find closed form answers analytically for particular statistics. This expresses, for example, in physics, what particle is it, this density function, okay? And also for particular couplings that you are assuming to switch from active to idle state, which is this CE parameter. And because you can express them in closed form analytically, that means you can estimate the risk, if you're talking about finance, or you can estimate the probability that you are operating in a particular region. And also in physics, in a similar way, you can estimate, you know, what am I going to observe in a particular experiment, right? And what is my observation uncertainty? And in my understanding, the reason they are used, for example, in finance as well is because and to some extent in IoT, is because when you're deploying services like this, a big question that we in academia do not understand is, it's not so much whether your service works well, is whether your service meets the stated objective. Meaning that when somebody signs up, when you see these terms and conditions and it says, you know, this service gives you A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and so on, this is an SLA, a service level agreement, essentially. And you need to have a good way of estimating whether your service will behave in that way. And in finance, if you're creating a model to analyze some market behavior or invest, a big problem is your model must be able to estimate its own failure or its own risk. Otherwise, people will be very skeptical about it and whether they will actually, you know, risk with it, right? Now, coming back to the particular problem, for example, the experiments we've run, as I said, they were with a BeagleBone platform and a conventional camera hardware. The application could be anything, as in motion detection, and then the camera waking up, grabbing a frame, getting some features, and sending it to the cloud service. For example, this could be a case where there's now some of these apps about well-being, and a big thrust in this, all these startups is being able to tell you, similar to these watches that tell you, you know, how many steps you've done and all these kind of things, is to be able to tell you if you're not moving, or if you're sitting in front of your computer and you have the wrong posture, yeah? So for example, when it detects that you haven't moved through not sending queries, or when you're moving but you're in the wrong posture, it can send you back an alert and say it seems you're not moving enough and so on, or you're not sitting up straight or something like that. So the experiment took place in an office in our lab. It was mostly oriented towards posture detection, as I mentioned, and then doing some subsequent analytics. We extracted a signature using the VLAD algorithm to compress it to the particular size per query, 256 by 32 bits. Laptops collecting queries from 10 devices. The laptops were the aggregators in this side. And then the coupling point was set based on the number of devices for the cloud billing. And an account in our service that didn't. And then there's a master instance that is scaling between 3 and 30 servers according to the query volume that we are observing, as I mentioned. And these are simulated experiments with Monte Carlo statistics. So as you see, for different distributions, the Monte Carlo is very close to the analytic experiment. So The Monte Carlo experiment is the marked lines, and the analytic result is the solid line per distribution here. And what you see here is the energy variability, oops, versus the coupling point here, right? And here are some real results with query volumes that we measured from the lab experiment. As you can imagine, most of the probability of an occurrence of a particular size, most of them are zero because there are no queries. And then you have a decaying histogram, which we can model as an exponential PDF. So this is the query volume within an interval of time, 60 seconds, and this is the probability of observing it. And if you assume, for example, an exponential PDF with a particular mean, you can use the equations to derive the theoretical estimation of the energy per device for particular time intervals of 1 minute and 20 minutes. And then you can see that the theoretical and experimental, this is the experimental measurement, this is the theoretical from the model, they can be reasonably close, both for the expectation of the energy and the variations with the real experiment, despite the simplicity of the two-state model that I mentioned and so on. So that's good. And the accuracy, of course, gets better as the time increases, right? Because of the use of the statistical model, you lose the notion of time resolution, of course. And in terms of particular real image experiments, then you can have different coupling rates for the energy of the device, which are ad hoc, which you have fixed in the system. And then you can have the optimal coupling coming from the model. And you can see that you can have certain reduction in the expected energy consumption for the 10 second and the 20 second, the 10 minute and the 20 minute interval, which ranges, you know, between, let's say, 15 to 20% versus ad hoc settings of the coupling here, right? And then the same results for the billing cost. If you optimize the billing based on the analysis, you can have savings in the order of 20% roughly. So that means that, this type of coupling-based models, if you give 2 out of 3 of the boxes, you can find the analytic parameters to tune the third box. For example, if you know the data gathering statistics and the energy of the system, the energy parameters of the system, you can optimize the billing. If you know the billing and the system parameters, you can optimize the data gathering. How often do you wake the devices up? And what should be the density function that should fit the data, you know? How you should shape the traffic, let's say. The caveats are that, of course, the model is simplistic. It has, let's say, 2 states per energy or billing. And some expressions with some PDFs may be complex to derive if you want to derive a closed form expression and not some computable expression, right? Any questions until now? Okay. Now, for the remaining part, I'll hopefully show you just a bit this. So this and the cloud service. This is sort of a camera we're using for results of a new project, which is called IOSIRE. It stands for Internet of Silicon Retinas. So this is a silicon retina. It comes from a company called Inilabs, which is a startup of ETH Zurich, right? What you have here is you have 2 cameras, a conventional pixel camera, which is overexposed at the moment and it has a very blurry image. And as you can see, the frame rate of the pixel camera is not good. But you also have what is called a neuromorphic camera, which means it's recording events in an asynchronous manner without a shutter. And the advantage of that, if I'm able to switch it to that mode, so I'll disable the display camera, is that, for example, when nothing is moving, it's not recording anything. So the power consumption is just the static power to power the hardware, which is very low. When something happens and something moves, it can record with very high speed, meaning that, for example, if you tune the capturing carefully, you can capture bullets passing in front, that level of speed. Or if you put a fan rotating around, you can capture the fan blade moving like this in front. So very slow, very, 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 very high speed capture. The power consumption is in the order of 20 milliwatts, when, for example, something like a fast GoPro camera would be in the order of 200 or 250 milliwatts, right? So it's an order of 10 change. The other advantage, which is a big advantage, is it doesn't have a shutter. So a conventional camera is a camera that does clack, 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 and captures frames, right? Every frame has full pixels on all rows. So that's very redundant. And from a power mode, is an overkill because you have zero power and then boom, like a huge power surge when you're capturing a frame. And most of these pixels across frames are very redundant anyway. You end up throwing them away because what you end up calculating is some notion of pattern or edge across, right? So that's the shutter problem and the power problem. The other big problem of having a shutter in a camera is that you can disable the camera very quickly, right? So for example, people that want to rob a place, what they do is they just do this. And they walk in. Basically, and if you don't use a visual spectrum, you can use an infrared. If you know the camera is infrared, you just shine an infrared light on it. By the time the shutter calibrates to close, and by the time it opens again, you're long gone, right? Now this one, because it doesn't have a shutter, even if I shine something in front, if I move, it will still detect patterns. So it will detect the source of light, right? And actually, if I close the conventional camera, you'll be able to see that hopefully a bit better. There's a slowdown now because of the projector as well. So you see, it's not blinding. So you can still detect patterns in the back, despite I'm bringing the light really in front of it, right? So the combination of the power consumption savings and the fact that the camera doesn't burn anything if nothing, if something is not happening, it's and the speed, it's a strong incentive for us to use it. Now, what are the problems we're addressing here? The first problem is there is no data. If you want to build machine learning based on this type of data, for example, something like an inception CNN or some sort of feature extraction and so on, you need to use millions of videos similar to the Google YouTube data set. But that means you have to go out and shoot them yourself because there are no neuromorphic videos of that scale, right? So the solution we're using in, or we're trying to do in this case is we are trying to build a model which will create a software emulation of how the camera works, and then we can, and that model would start from pixels. So it would take, for example, the YouTube data set, the YouTube A10 data set, and convert it into neuromorphic events. And that means then you can piggyback on the availability of these huge data sets, convert them into neuromorphic format, and train a machine learning algorithm based on these, right? And then you have to find ways to validate that the data set is okay, and that the events you calculate are accurate. And this is an open area. At the moment, there's very, very little work in that area of converting pixels to neuromorphic videos. So that's something interesting for us. There was another thing I wanted to say on that. And I think that was, right, metrics are needed. So how do you know the results are accurate? So how do you know, for example, that your artificial video converted to neuromorphic events is accurate enough, right? Versus if you would shoot that video with this camera. And the third thing is, the analogy is, it's the same as if you build a machine learning with artificial data. I mean, it's the same as, you know, when you have a child, it learns what an elephant is by watching it on TV. It hasn't actually been to the zoo to see the elephant, right? But when you actually see the 3D object, you still learn. You still appreciate that it's the same object, right? So that's an open question. If we train such models with artificial neuromorphic data, will they be able to recognize with the same accuracy as if you've trained them with real neuromorphic data, right? Now, for the last part of the talk, do I have another 5 minutes or? Yeah? Okay, cool. I just want to show you a little bit the service. So if you go to the to didn't.com, you can log in, or if you, you know, you can make an account simply by an email. It doesn't ask you for any personal, other personal information, just an email and a password. And if you want, you can do it now. And I'll just log in with mine. I think I'm already logged in, actually. So let me just close this and go in. So what do you see here? When you enter, so here we are. You have a folder with some data that you get a priori when you open an account. And it's some examples of a service and of some applications that you can run, which are very simple, like a face detector, a template matching, merging of images, and a video transcoding service, a SIF detector, etc. There's a README file as well. This is all a front end, which is used by the browser. So of course you can, you know, you can use it as a storage facility. So you can copy things, you know, create folders. So copy them, and then create a new folder called QMUL, and then you just paste them. It's similar to Dropbox, right? So that's very common. Paste them here, and then beyond the copying and pasting, you can also start servers through this. And by servers, I mean instances on AWS. And these instances could be of any size you want. So once this finishes, I can hopefully do this. Let's make sure we close some of these windows. Taking longer than I thought. I might have copied something very large. Doesn't matter. We can try with another example. So, let me try with this. Now, the other interesting thing that you can do is, there we go, so that finished, right? Is you can start an instance. And what is an instance? An instance is literally one of the servers I was mentioning in the talk. You can pick an image default, the number of processing cores you want to have. You can have a GPU as well, or just one core, two core, and so on. The memory in terms of gigabytes, and the hard drive. And for example, my students now using this in their experiments, they don't bother too much with sort of departmental resources because, let me just start one. Let's say April 6. You can give it a name if you want. Three, yeah. And this is the cost per hour. And if you save it, it costs about 1 penny per day. What does saving means? It means that, so the instance is set up, it will take between 1 minute to 10 minutes to start, and you see here it's initializing. When you start it, you'll get something called Jupyter. Have you heard about Jupyter before? Who has heard it? Okay. I suggest you have a look, because Jupyter is the interface for machine learning now and high performance. Most of the toolboxes like TensorFlow and other libraries will give you a Jupyter front end. So you can use Jupyter when you write your paper to directly put the results of your paper in a demonstrable format. And it looks like this when I open it. This is another instance I started before. You need a password, which you can get by clicking here. This is the password. Paste. This is the main Jupyter interface. Initially, you have no notebooks or terminals running. If you want to run a terminal on the instance, you simply say terminal, new terminal. And it opens a standard SSH terminal. And on this machine, you are root. So you can do sudo apt-get install whatever you want. Let's say I want to install Finger. The password is here. Notice that everything is HTTPS, so the fact that you are transmitting the password here is secure. Let me paste it. Do it again, paste. Didn't like my password. Try again. Copy. And paste. Let me see. Ah, didn't copy. Paste. So the I was copying the wrong one. So this is the right one. The right one should be this one. See? That has to do with the level. Anyway, so what you can do here is you can install any package you want, you can start your services, and the Jupyter frontend also allows you to start Python notebooks, which means, for example, you can type the Python control code for TensorFlow or any other service you are using. And I'll show you some examples of, if you go here, for Jupyter Python notebooks examples. You get all kinds of things pre-cooked for you, right? So anything on data processing, machine learning, and so on. And you can download them and insert them in the service. Now, the nice thing is you can start an experiment and it will start on the number of instances you have been using here. And then this will keep on running and it will take care of everything. So the finding the lowest price, maintaining the instance, keys, you don't have to deal with any of that. It just runs, and when you want to stop it, you go to your control panel and say, for example, for this instance, delete. If I delete it, it will delete, gone. So for example, students of mine have run 80 of these terminals and have processed in the order of, let's say, 3 million videos in one day. And the cost for that was £10, literally. If I had to go through system support to do that, and that was one day from the start to the end, it would be in the order of, you know, a month, typically. If I take into account that they have to create virtual machines, give me access, log me in, and all that. Yeah, so that's, so of course, you know, we are still improving things on how it works. We have a number of users from UCL, Cambridge, EPFL, actually, some people. Some people from Harvard as well. So if you want to give it a shot, it's free. So you get a free credit. You only need an email. And if you run out of credit, at the moment, you can delete your account, make a new one. It will give you another, whatever, 5 or 10 it is, and so on. So it's, we call it a painless way of running algorithms on instances without having to bother with everything I talked about. So, yeah. And of course, make sure to back your data if you use it. Back up your data, not just put everything there, because you know it's reliable, but you know we're not at the level of Google, let's say, at reliability, right? So that's roughly what I had to say. Please ask me any questions, and thank you for staying. Thank you.